So we've seen incredible advances in artificial intelligence over the past year. Computers are now dominating Go and poker, recognizing handwriting, speech, driving cars, and translating between languages. What are your predictions for how AI will change computer security?
When you talk about finding deviations from normal behavior, I think that AI systems are going to be very useful in comparing all kinds of strange behaviors to what had been done before and finding the deviations and warning about them. So I'm optimistic about AI being useful in defense, but not in offense.
What AI and machine learning is great on is lots of data and dealing with it effectively. And what we're dealing with the serious attacks are anomalous solution situations. And AI does not look like it's going to be useful there.
So moving on to quantum computing. So what are your thoughts about the risks and also the advancements in the past year with quantum computing and quantum resistant public key algorithms?
Quantum crypto per se doesn't seem to be moving as fast as quantum computation. 2031 seems like a long, long ways off from now, so hard to tell.
It could turn out that quantum computers will be able to break all the supposedly quantum-proof schemes that we are developing now, based, for example, on lattices. There's no proof that it will be impossible to break lattice problems in a polynomial amount of time.
If you think about the advanced encryption standard, there was good, solid research on building block structured algorithms for a good 10, 15 years before Rheindahl. I'm not seeing that same level of mathematical research behind the proposed quantum-resistant algorithms, and that's what concerns me about adopting them as standards.
So there are so many possibilities and worries when you think about what will happen in 20 or 30 years that I wouldn't lose too much sleep over quantum computers.
So the new U.S. Attorney General, Jeff Sessions, was quoted just a little while ago saying, and I'm going to quote him, as it's critical that national security and criminal investigators be able to overcome encryption. Do you have any idea what that means from a technical perspective and maybe its implications for policy over the next 4 years?
Yeah, the report that came out in December was a very interesting report. It was a joint report, and it was a bipartisan report. It was joint between the Judiciary Committee and the Energy and Commerce Committee. And they had four conclusions, which I thought, I got them here, which I think are worth reviewing. First, which I think is the most important point, and they do list it first, any measure that weakens encryption works against the national interest. It means that encryption is a tool that we have to preserve its strength. We have to keep it as one of the fundamental building blocks of our secure internet. Number two, encryption technology is a global technology that is widely and increasingly available around the world. Just a fact of life. Any policy that you try to derive to deal with encryption has to deal with the fact that we live on a planet that's well connected. Third one is a bit longer, but it basically says there's no one-size-fits-all solution, that there's a variety of stakeholders here. They have different requirements. You can't expect to have one approach. It's going to work everywhere. And the last one says that Congress should encourage cooperation between technology companies and law enforcement. So I think this is a well-written report. It's worth reading. And I think the conclusions are in the right direction.
Our CIA director, who was from a few weeks ago, John Brannon, I mean, he said that U.S. companies dominate the international market, and it was a theoretical ability of foreign companies to have those encryption capabilities. I don't know if you have any thoughts about that, Adi.
He probably didn't know that the AES was imported.
Can you remind me who invented AES? It was two Belgian researchers. Can you remind me who invented SHA-3? Can you remind me who invented differential cryptanalysis? Israelis. Can you remind me who invented linear cryptanalysis? Japanese researcher. I can go on and on. It's an international game. It's not, it may be a strong influence by the US, but it is not uniquely American. And I can assure you that any one of my students will be capable of writing good crypto code.
So the crypto community used to be pretty lined up around a few algorithms, but it seems like recently there's been a lot of fracturing into camps that are favoring different elliptic curves, different standards, different protocols, different algorithms. So what would you do if you were designing a system today?
I think algorithm agility, despite all its difficulties, is still essential. Because you're going to have, in effect, coalition forces, multi-corporate conglomerates. I just think we're not going to be able to get around that one, even if, as I think is the case, a very small number of algorithms dominate the usage.
I think we should separate between secret key algorithms and public key algorithms. I'm very confident that AES will remain secure for the foreseeable future. And I'm less sure about the prospects of all our public key schemes to survive forever. So I don't think we really need the agility. We don't really have to put five different secret key schemes, but I would be in favor of having several different public keys.
Well, we're seeing a richer set of environments we have to build to, too. I mean, the Internet of Things is putting very tight engineering demands on what crypto we can use and so on. So yeah. Having a larger suite of algorithms has benefits.
So the best defense is a good offense. People who live in glass houses shouldn't throw stones, which is right in the cyber domain. And if somebody hacks us, should we hack back?
My view is that the defensive techniques, the things that look like, not the same techniques as cryptography, but this look like cryptography, in particular, logical, proven correct sort of code for solution of things, particularly the confinement problem, that is vastly underrated. And if anything like the resources currently being spent on interactive security, virus screening, fighting back, all the rest of those things, were spent on the improvement of the logical functioning of devices, which is largely a matter of improving, you know, making another very, very big improvement in the quality of programming, that we would get much, much better results.
I will applaud that. I absolutely agree that's critical going forward.
Actually, if you talk about private sector attacks, I'm completely against hacking back in revenge. When you talk about governments, I would flip the order of things. So it's not that after I'm being hacked by another government, my government should hack the attackers, but my government should hack before in order to learn about what are the tools and what are the plans of that other government. So that's a much better policy.
Please join me in thanking our our panel for a really interesting conversation today.